Joining us right now are two of our favourites, other than the wonderful James Ashby, running for One Nation in the seat of Keppel at the upcoming Queensland election. Back him in as hard as you possibly can. And the wonderful Linda Scott, who's in Canberra, because 428,000 mayors are currently in Canberra for the local government conference. What was first on the list? International affairs, the Trump presidency, or rates, roads and rubbish? What did we get to, Linda? Because a lot of people
you
have got views
well
on
think
climate
all
change...
Things. Paul Murray, but look, we do have, we've got 1,200 mayors and councillors here in Canberra this week. It's huge, and most of them are here to talk about their own financial sustainability. We've seen the cost and outlays of local governments flatline, while the expenditure of state and federal governments has gone up across the board. We're doing much more with less. We're very efficient, but we are not financially sustainable. We do need a bit more funding from the Commonwealth.
All right, let's get to the poll. 54% of people saying Australia's heading in the wrong direction. Prime Minister disapproval. We can get into that. James, I'm deliberately going to make this an open question, but why do you think 54% of Australians now think we're headed in the wrong direction? A major change, even in the past 18 months.
Well, the simple fact is that people are seeing less bang for buck. They appear to be doing it tougher. There's less money in their accounts at the end of the week. There's no savings. There's no money left over. The kids are suffering. The mums and dads are certainly cutting back on a raft of different measures. And if you actually click on the female contingent of those surveyed, they have a higher dislike to what's going on in society right now. So it's the women. The bloke's probably a little less likely to feel the pinch because they're probably not handling the pay packets. If they're anything like my mum, she used to take Dad's pay packet at the end of the week and she managed it. So she knew the full effects of what was happening to the household budget. So that's why people don't have much confidence in the economy and certainly in this Labor government.
Linda, why do you think 54% of the country thinks we're headed in the wrong direction?
Look, it's a significant figure, but the reality is, of course, people have not yet seen most of the Albanese's cost of living measures, which kick in, of course, this week. Every Australian who's working gets a gets a tax cut, increased superannuation, increased paid parental leave. There's so many different cost of living measures that kick in with the new financial year, which, of course, has only begun this year. I do want to say, though, it also, of course, matters which poll you look at, right? Of course, a recent poll showed that 73% of Australians...
Watch out.
73% of Australians think moving towards renewables is the right direction. So a huge majority of Australians, when you poll across the board, don't think that moving towards 12 nuclear power plants is the right direction. You've got to look at all these polls across time and across the issues.
Yeah. I think it's about... I think,
don't you cross the floor, Linda.
Yeah, but she's not going to. I think that, I truly think that it's the inflation fear, right? When the inflation number came out last week, that the verbal bomb of that, right, and it goes into... And it's one of those things. There are these moments when, and James, you know this, right, which is, as does Linda, but there are these moments where there's a certain type of news that will get all fired up about, there's a certain type of news that the 6pm news will fire up about, certain type of news the papers will all be into, and then there's this type of news that makes it to FM radio, right, or TikTok or social media, and the inflation figure last week made it to that level. It went far, wide and loud because it helps inform the potential of the rate rise. Again, it's not me making it up. It's not me cheering it on. It's the Reserve Bank saying that they didn't even talk about cutting. Instead, they were right on the verge of lifting. The information going back up pushes them back in that direction. I think if there is an interest rate rise, and obviously I hope not, I don't want to pay any more than anyone else does, but if it does, that's the one that the government's going to have to own, and they're going to own it hard. And I think the politics, as it did positively and negatively for Howard, as it did positively and negatively for Rudd, it's going to turn on Albo. And this meeting in August is... The stakes couldn't be higher, James. The politics behind it, massive.
Well, you've only got to talk to businesses like I have this week. I've spoken to a couple of restaurants who've actually changed their menu list to actually make cheaper menu items. You may not get as much on your plate, but at the end of the day, they're making it more affordable for people to go and eat out. And if you go and talk to the bloke behind the counter at the butcher, he's telling you red meat sales are way down because people cannot afford the red meat at the moment because cost of living's just through the roof. More sausages, more chicken, More cheaper cuts. That's what people are going for to be able to sustain the family. It's hard now. You know, Coles used to run that ad, feed a family for 10 bucks. Good luck. You can't do it these days. And that's the pinch that people are feeling. So no matter which way you carve this up, it can be interest rates, it can be inflation, whichever way, people are feeling the pinch. They just know at the end of the week they don't have as much to play with in their bank balances.
Linda, let's talk about the Greens because, you know, my worldview is that I think they're the most dangerous thing on the ballot, but I'm also aware that they have a stubborn number of supporters. It sits somewhere around 10. It goes up to 12 in a poll. It goes up to 14. But there is a significant number of people who keep wanting to park their vote with the Greens, right? You're a progressive member of the Labor Party, so you prefer them to vote for you than vote for the Greens. But how does nothing ever happen to their support when their senators come out like Jordan Steele John did and basically back in the use of graffiti on a war memorial to make a point about a war on the other side of the world? Like, how is there no line that ever seems to hurt them? Why do you think that criticism of them is seemingly so impenetrable? I'm not talking about mine. I'm just talking about the general Australian public, that there are people who go, you know what? I'm going to keep backing in these people who say and do stupid things all the time.
Well, look, it is not new news, is it, that the Greens have taken some pretty nutty public policy positions. And I do agree with you that this is one of them. Obviously, as you know, I tried to get my own council, the City of Sydney, to remove hate speech graffiti in an hour. Unfortunately, Clover Moore voted that down. But, you know, we do believe in removing graffiti. But I've had Greens on my own council say that we should just let graffiti run wild wherever it is, that it's just such a great feature of our cities. Something that I certainly don't agree with. So, look, I mean, I think it is true, though, and you're right to identify that there are a group of rusted-on Greens voters, and that is something that's emerged in our lifetimes. They're pretty stuck on the Greens. They're not going to shift their vote. For many young Australians, it is also the case that they've been Greens voters for much of their voting life or all of their voting life. And as we see that generational slide change through Australia, as we start to see younger voters becoming middle-aged voters, what will happen? I think it's a really interesting question. The big problem, though, I want to counter to that, though, Paul, is the Liberals. The Liberals are not able to pick up these young voters. And so what we are seeing is as young voters start to vote progressive, unlike other demographics in the past, they're sticking with their progressive vote, be that Labor or Greens. And that is a real demographic problem for the conservative side of politics that they have not yet confronted.
Yeah, but the raw, I mean, look, you know, James, obviously the raw numbers, if you put, say, the Liberal Party, the UAP, One Nation, all kind of in the same world, that number is bigger than the left number in Australia. Mm. It's the preference discipline in part in and around the Greens that gets us there. I've got to go to a break in a second, but just a quick response to this here, James, about why they are seemingly so impenetrable. Because even, you know, the stories and criticism of them and this senator today about the graffiti, that was on the ABC, but it just bounces off like an arrow.
Yeah, but the problem is, Linda, you say vote for Labor first, but the problem is you're saying vote Greens second. That's Labor's mantra. If you do preference arrangements with the Greens and you let them off lightly, you let them get away with everything, and that is the problem that we face today. The other big thing I'll recognise is the Greens play a very good game when it comes to door knocking. If you have a look at seats around Brisbane, they're knocking on doors left, right and centre, and I've seen young kids answer the doors. Friends of mine who've got 18-year-olds just about to vote, and the 18-year-olds say, I'm going to vote for them. They seem like really nice people when they come to the door.
Well, it helps
the
when they're also
play
saying
a really good door-knocking game.
Yeah, it also helps when, let's get the 16-year-old vote and let's legalise pot. I mean, all of that is part of the issue too. Yeah.